is by ARifTapan. Arif received his BA in Turkish language and literature from Boğaziçi University in Istanbul, and his MA in cultural studies from the Şehir University. At present, he is a research assistant and PhD candidate at Boğaziçi. And his research and publications focus on 19th century modern Ottoman literatures. And he is especially interested in 19th century Armeno-Turkish novels and periodicals. And in that connection, the topic of the presentation he will make today is reading 19th century Armeno-Turkish novels as another phenomenon, a narratological perspective.
Hey everyone, Parev says, thanks for having us today. Okay. My presentation is about two Armeno-Turkish novels from 19th century, and I will proceed like this. Firstly, I will mention briefly the relationship between Armenian alphabet and Turkish in order to see all possibilities. The earliest known example of Armeno-Turkish published works is from 18th century, from 1727. In Hasmik Stepanyan's book, almost 2,000 Armeno-Turkish books, 400 theater texts are mentioned. There are 99 periodicals and 20 manuscript newspapers and magazines published after 1840. When considered geographically, it can be seen that these Armeno-Turkish texts are printed in nearly 50 different cities around the world, in nearly 200 different printing houses. Between 1850 and 1890, only in Istanbul, there were about 100 periodicals published by Armenians, and 54 of them were partly or completely Armeno-Turkish. It would be helpful to make into consideration the interaction area of Armeno-Turkish literary texts in the 19th century so that we can have an idea where they stand in 19th century Ottoman literary production. Here we need to keep in mind that Armeno-Turkish literary texts were not followed only by the Armenian community in the period. Here is an example. This booklet written by Hacı Beyzade Ahmet Muhtar, and the subject of the booklet is how to read or write Armeno-Turkish text. As opposed to what has been claimed, 19th century Armeno-Turkish text has a sphere of influence which includes not only Armenian community but also Ottoman Muslim readers and others. When I scan Armeno-Turkish newspapers I will work in my PhD thesis, I notice in these newspapers, in addition to Armenian and Armeno-Turkish, Ottoman advertisements, articles, and news can also take place. Garabet Panosyan's newspaper includes petitions of some Muslim readers, for example. Here we see another examples from the Armeno-Turkish grammar books, and we should mention it's not always used to learn Ottoman Turkish or Armenian, as you see. And here is another example, an Armeno-Turkish quatrain from folk literature, probably from 14th or 15th century. And this is one of the famous Armeno-Turkish journal, Mecmuai Havadis, written and published by Hovsep Vartanian, who is also the writer of the first Armeno-Turkish novel, Akabi Hikyayesi. But still, it might be objected that 19th century Armeno-Turkish literary texts might only have been printed in certain places and in a small number, and thus that they only reached a not so large literate mass, that their spheres of influence were not wide. According to Ayaydin Cebes' study, from 1851 to 1893, 40 copyrighted modern Armeno-Turkish literary texts were printed in Istanbul, Izmir, Smyrna, and Aleppo alone. This also shows that the text's spheres of influence were not so limited and were wider than has been supposed. When we consider the 19th century Armeno-Turkish literary text produced before the first Turkish novel published in Arabic scripts, which is Taşuk-u Talat ve Fitnat, which means love affair of Talat and Fitnat, we see following modern original Armeno-Turkish literary texts whose authors are known. So, as far as we know, we have four modern Armeno-Turkish novels before the first Turkish novel in Arabic script. Hovsep Vartanian, the author of Akabi Hikyayesi, was an Ottoman Armenian born in Istanbul. He is most known as Vartan Pasha since he was in Bahriye Nezareti, ministry which is responsible for the Ottoman Navy, for 25 years and got the title Pasha. He was a statesman as well as an author and journalist. Although the historical information on Hovsep Vartanian is still limited, we can find most comprehensive information on his life in Turkish in the works of Kevor Pamukcuya. But for many years, it was discussed who was the author of Akabi Hikayesi, since it was first published anonymously, as you see, without an author name, and shortly after the novel was printed, Akabi Hikayesi was reported by Cardinal Andon Hasunyan and forbidden by the Vatican Inquisition on the grounds that it was contrary to Catholic belief, as Murat Cankara also mentioned that. Akabi Hikayesi was first published in Istanbul in 1851. In 1953, after more than one century, the book was translated into Armenian by Karnik Stepanyan and published in Yerevan. The main heroes of the text, which consist of 16 chapters, are Akabi Dudu, as can be understood from the title of the book, and Hagop Aga. The main story is here the big love between Akabi and Hagop, and it's the sectarian separation between the Ottoman Armenians that constitutes the basic conflict in this story. I think it can be said that Akabi Hikayesi is the first Romeo and Juliet prototype in modern Ottoman literature in the modern novel form. The only obstacle for Akabi and Hagop, who are in love with each other and want to be together, is that they belong to sects of different beliefs. Akabi is from an Orthodox and Hagop is from a Catholic congregation, even though both of them are Armenian. In 1847 and 46 and 47 in Istanbul, which is the narrative tense in the novel, there is a controversy between these two communities that will lead to hostility. In the text we read, the stories of Akabi and Hagop, who cannot reach each other because of this controversy between the two communities. It can be seen that there is not a pure love story here, and that the narrator of Akabi Hikayesi touches many different issues through this love story. The narrator in this story is a narrator who has multiple profiles and different positions rather than having a single stable profile and position. The second novel I focus here, Bir Sefil Zevce, A Miserable Wife, written by Hovsep Maruş, was first published again in Istanbul in 1868. We still do not have any reliable information about Maruş today. Everything we know about the author is based on the fact that he is the author of Bir Sefil Zevce. Naturally, we can only make inferences about the author by looking at the text itself. It can be predicted that Hovsep Maruş is Catholic, that he knows languages other than Armenian and Ottoman Turkish, and that he is familiar with European culture and open to improvement and modernity. In this novel, we read the love of a married woman, Vartuk Dudu and Sebuh Muhib. The separation between sex in the first novel is seen here among Catholics only in a single sect, and this confrontation is between supporters of modernization, Europeanization, and the opposing conservatives. The main element that established the conflict in the novel is a foundation which is called Amazgazt Ingerutyun. When we look at the studies which consider Armeno-Turkish texts in general and Akabi Hikayesi and or Bir Sefil Zevce, no doubt we can say that these texts stirred up the Turkish academy's interest after the 2000s. However, there are some deficiencies in the studies of Armeno-Turkish novels, especially when the issue is addressed in the context of the Tanzimat-period novel. The first problematic approach on this subject is that the position of these novels in Tanzimat novels cannot be determined precisely. Should these novels be included in Tanzimat period novels? If so, is it enough to examine these novels in the common forms and types of Tanzimat period novels? Or is it possible to mention an authenticity that directly originates from the fact that these novels are Armeno-Turkish novels and so that locates them elsewhere? When we consider the specific studies so far, it can be seen it's possible to evaluate the studies on the Armeno-Turkish novels in two ways. Firstly, Armeno-Turkish novels, when they are studied on their own, have been problematized around some certain themes and images, such as the exclusion of Armeno-Turkish novels by Republican Turkish literary historiography, the issues of identity and modernization, and repositioning the novels in the sense of Tanzimat period novel. Secondly, when the novels are studied as a part of the Tanzimat period novel, we see that Armeno-Turkish novels are presented in the studies in a cause-effect relationship as if they are only the manifestation of a purpose or again around some specific themes only related with Tanzimat period novel, such as religious conflict and social disintegration, Europeanism or dandism. In other words, these novels have been approached as if they were only social and political documents of their times, not literary texts. Some studies on the 19th century Armeno-Turkish novels of course have made significant contributions to the field, but nonetheless the method in these studies ignores the fact that these novels are literary texts regardless of anything. My suggestion, which is a narratological approach, comes into play exactly at this point. Narratological readings of Armeno-Turkish novels are hardly ever seen. However, even apart from Armeno-Turkish texts, this type of reading on 19th century Ottoman novels is also very limited. Although there are many studies on Tanzimat period novels in general, and on Armeno-Turkish novels in particular, why are these novels read only through certain themes I have mentioned here? Is the ultimate purpose of these novels only to convey their authors' political, religious, sociological, and moral messages to 19th century readers? Or is it possible for these novels to be only literary phenomena on their own? Another reason why I suggest a narratological reading of these novels is that a narratological approach can reveal what these novels indicate us, especially at the point where they are not subjected to the common themes and conflicts of the 19th century Ottoman novel. So in order to answer this question, I used in my study Waldschmidt's criteria and Raymond Kanaan focalization model with three different facets. On the other hand, it would be helpful to mention where does a narratological reading take us and which possibilities does it offer. One of the most significant points which characterize the Armeno-Turkish novels' narrators is that the narrators go outside of the stories they narrate and declare an idea. According to narrators, of course, they have reasons for doing so. But more important than this, the main issue here is, I think, how the narrators do this, how they construct their narrative structure, and which narration strategies they use. The first thing, providing direct information to the addressees, to the readers. This information flow is not in a specific order and is related to the narration moment. Wherever the narrators consider it necessary, they stop telling the stories and give out of the story information related to their issues. The second thing, causalization. If everything described in the story has a cause and a consequence, the narrative will be easy to understand. By causalization, the narrators will carry themselves in a reliable position also. The third one, criticizing and making propaganda. The propagandist and critical attitude of the narrators can be seen as their most characteristic feature. Behind the forbidden love of Akabi and Hagop and of Vartuktudu and Seguk Muhib, the narrators criticize everything and everyone that forbids these loves. They make propaganda since the stories, since the society that narrators dream of is a society that is purely homogeneous and indiscreet, intellectual and fully developed, where people do not fall apart for any reason. The fourth thing, caricaturizing as a narrator technique. and the final negotiating with the readers with the addresses. The narrators negotiate some issues with their addresses in some more complex forms of communication, like free will, freedom of thought, equality, improvement, wholeness of love, secularism, and so on and so forth. Here is an example. The A means the addresses, the readers, and the N is the narrator, the other voice. Whoa, good heavens, why would I let my daughter to meet some stranger that I don't know? Without any expectations, no way that I let this happen. You must be joking. Lady, if such thing happens, if a stranger would meet with your daughter, if that stranger is well civilized, nothing would be wrong. Because if they desire to see each other, they make this happen in any way before you know it. Indeed, I cannot accept such a thing. Some nearby person joins the conversation. What does it mean that my wife meets someone else? Am I that kind of person? No, no, I didn't mean that. If everyone in such a meeting behaved themselves, nothing would go. Even everybody would have fun. I don't need that kind of fun. Anyway, so many young men aim that, which overall tendency is to have European style of life, where gatherings are European. Ferace, long overcoat worn by a woman during that time, is taken off, but we let none of them happen. Not in this life. Well then, our community would not improve current situation unless people are nurtured with European culture. Forget it. I wish we would not have been awakened that much. Don't you see? Our world becomes deteriorated day by day, and it's clear it will be much further if ignorant people have such ideas. Oh God, help us. We will be in great trouble otherwise. Although you are opposed to practices that we have desire for, it is of no avail that European lifestyle is favored each day because good trends always move ahead and no way that we will fall behind as Europe forwards. You don't want to recognize this today, but you will have to soon. I can state that if we leave everything aside and consider these two Armeno-Turkish novels only as literary text, we can see what they could show us independently of the most known themes, debates, and approaches of the 19th century modern Ottoman novel. By a narratological approach, on the one hand, I have discussed the narrative structures of these two Armeno-Turkish novels in the context of 19th century Ottoman novel, and again in this context, identified deficient or erroneous analysis of the novels. On the other hand, I have been able to confirm the assertions proposed up to now about the novels and to support these claims structurally. Therefore, it can be stated that a narratological perspective does not only fill the gaps in analysis of both Armeno-Turkish novels in particular and the other 19th century Ottoman novels in general, it also gives us the possibility to support some claims about the novels and verify the claims about their narrative structures, plots, and stories theoretically. Although 19th century Armeno-Turkish novels are a component of the Tanzimat-period novel, they are also more than that. After a narratological reading of the novels, I can state that these novels have multi-layered, elaborate, distinctive narratives and narrator structures, contrary to what has been supposed so far. I should also state that a narratological reading does not put these Armeno-Turkish novels in a different place in the Tanzimat-period novels, but in the discourse of Tanzimat-period novel, such a reading promises to show us the literary narrative values of these texts. This opportunity will create a much enriched reading ground for the current readings of both 19th century Armeno-Turkish novels in particular and the other Tanzimat-period novels in general. In the end, my study offers a narratological analysis that I hope will contribute to the readings of both 19th century Armeno-Turkish novel and the modern Ottoman novel, but it also raises other questions beyond that. Could a literary phenomenon stem from the fact that these novels are Armeno-Turkish novels? How much do the Armeno-Turkish novels represent the Tanzimat-period novel? Is it possible to come across another lingual phenomena in these novels since they are published in the Armenian rather than the Arabic alphabet? Can Armeno-Turkish novels be incorporated into minor literature? I believe many more like these questions I ask here and many more novels like I discussed in this study are still waiting to be discovered. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ari.